malty, mothball munching malt mates. Yes, thank you to Rose in Texas for that malt mention, introducing, as it does, here in the Manx Bothy in the Isle of Man, a whisky review. 450. My goodness, they're fairly stacking up. And I'm about to review a blended whisky called Black Bottle. Some of you may not recognise this because this is the new version of Black Bottle, which is distinctly different from the old version, and I'm going to tell you why. But before I do, I'll just mention that this is in fact a re-review of whisky review number 16. My goodness, way back near the beginning of Ralphie.com. And when I was in a different location, I was in fact in Glasgow at the time, living in Scotland. And I bought a bottle of Black Bottle and was really impressed by the big peak moment that it was. And in fact, I stated in the rather short 5 minutes, 17 second video that I thought that you could put a glass of Black Bottle down to someone who was inexperienced with whisky and they might mistake it for one of the Isle of Malts, because it was simply such a nice, rounded, distinctive, peaty moment. Well, things have changed. We're 5 years later and we're coming back to re-review Black Bottle. Has time changed it? Oh yes, it has. Starting with the nose. Bear in mind, this is bottled. It's a blended whisky, bottled at 40%. And I've actually got a bottle of the old style, just for comparison, the old style Black Bottle. This happens to be the 10-year-old. They did three versions of Black Bottle. The non-age statement standard Black Bottle, which you can actually still find available in some shops. If you see it, I recommend you buy it. Then there's the 10-year-old, which I bought from my stash back in 2004. And there's also the rarer 15-year-old, which in fact is really quite a nice aged peated whisky. Now that the blend has settled down in the glass, let's put my nose to it and tell you all about it. Wood sap, grain, corn whisky, grainy Highland malt notes. I'm looking for peat. I'm still looking for peat, but I won't be finding any because there's very little there now. I have never come across a blended whisky in my entire life which has changed so suddenly as Black Bottle has. This has been a fairly recent rebranding exercise for the owners, Byrne Stewart, and I must say, I like the bottle. It's got that nice oblong shape, still a black bottle with that nice old-fashioned but quite visible distinctive label. Great packaging, but perhaps they needed it, because as a blended whisky, it's changed so much. And as a result of this change, people who know Black Bottle and who buy this, their first reaction will be one of disappointment. But what I'm going to suggest is, if you can get past the lack of peatiness and let the nose just settle down a bit, maybe add a drop of water, tiny wee drop of water, because it's a very young nosing blend now. You'll find that that initial slight off-putting young sappiness that's coming from reconditioned oak casks will actually dissipate slightly. It'll kind of recede further into the back of the experience and be replaced by more fresh fruitiness from what is well-made malt spirit content. There's some banana, there's some green apple, there's some complex grain going on, some bitter grain in there, I'm thinking Deanston. And there's a savoury note. There's a slight camphor eau de cologne note, which I would associate actually with Tobermory. The initial disappointment when you come to the nose, given a bit of time, once you acclimatise to it, it does improve and you start to get a little bit of cinnamon apple, baked apple notes. A little bit more complex spices going on. Taste-wise, young, very young. Interestingly, there's a certain intensity to this, even at 40%, that will allow it to take a bit more water, which is unusual for a blended whisky nowadays that's bottled at 40%. So I'm going to suggest that you persevere with this on the flavour, allow it a little bit of time to develop. There's that spiciness, a fruitiness, banana and apple tends to be quite the main feature for me. There's a growing hint, sense of vanilla and honey. There's a little bit of peat in there that's starting to exert itself. But the peat is totally overshadowed by the youth of the spirit in the casks. It's almost as if the collective of the malt and the grain whiskey is about 2 years younger than it used to be. But I do suspect strongly that in fact it's that with modern refilled casks, particularly reassembled casks, simply it's a fact that the experience we get as drinkers is of a whisky that's much younger tasting than it actually is when we compare it to the whiskies we've tasted even 3 or 4 years ago. The arrival is quite immediate, quite dramatic. It's slightly phenolic, but not peat phenols. There's an intensity, slight bitterness. It's very much part and parcel of the grain, the malt grain, the malted barley. The development, it's fairly short, but there is an intensity. It has character. It has a certain charm to it. But this whiskey ain't what it was. No way. That's the truth, in my opinion. It's just a little bit edgy in the finish. There's that roughness creeps in from undermatured malt. As a mixer, great. Compared to other blended whiskies, the way things are going, it does hold its own. But in terms of a blend mark, give me a minute. I'm going to give this 83 out of 100. And it's a blend of Scotch grain whiskey from column stills and Scotch malted barley whiskey from pot stills. Now, I'm going to finish off this review by highlighting some of the old bottlings. See the 10-year-old. Worth looking out for if you can find it at auctions, because it's a good example of a quality blended whisky which has never been made in any great volume. And it's the sort of whisky that it looks the part, great as a present for someone that doesn't really like malt whiskies. And it's the sort of whisky that will crop up at some point in the auction houses and be worth considering. In fact, it's still got the price in the back of £19.99. So $33 when I bought this. I'm not quite sure what that is in euros. I've not been following the exchange rate. But that was in February 2004. And when I bought it for my whiskey stash, it's one of these situations, buy today, drink in a few years' time. Well, I've noted this is a masterclass of blend skill and its quality components. And there's the receipt, the original receipt when I bought it from one of the whiskey shops anyway. And it's something you might like to consider. It's all very well when we have our whiskey collections, we can keep a logbook or a spreadsheet of what we've got. But if you have something, just a wee note tied on a label, it goes around the bottle, it gives that little bit of a timeline to whiskies. Now, bear in mind, I buy whiskies regularly, not to drink today, not to drink tomorrow, but to drink in 10, 20, or even 30 years' time if I live that long. And the whole idea is that things are changing. You and I know that. What we are aware in this information age is this: the rate of change, the rate of change in communities around us, and in particular in the world. It works in good ways, it works in bad ways. And one of the bad good ways is that we can see that whiskies we have enjoyed and we do enjoy today, they're not going to be around forever. And even on a modest budget, you can buy maybe one or two bottles that you can tuck away in the back of a cupboard. It doesn't need to be a big stash, just a little one. But you have that knowledge that over the years, at some point for a special occasion, you can go back to a bottle that is now historical bottling. And you know that in proper storage, you can rediscover the flavour and the smell that you enjoyed all these years ago. And it's amazing how something that you smell and taste can bring back floods of memories, particularly if you're sitting over a book of photographs or looking at an old movie. And it's something as we get older, as we all get older, as they say, nostalgia is wasted on the young. The young have really young kids, they've got no point of reference, they've got no historical points of reference in which to base the sense of nostalgia. Nostalgia is something which is the reserve of older people who are getting on and have more of a timeline into the past with a historical, a receding historical points of reference from a point in which the world, really, maltmates, was a different place. Some things change, some things don't. Change is inevitable. And for people who are just getting into whiskey now, for the first time, and going out into a liquor shop to buy the first bottle, they'll buy a bottle of this and they'll enjoy it because they've never had the older versions as a point of reference, just like we've never had previous versions as points of reference until we went to an auction to buy a bottle or two. And they'll judge it in its own merits. And this bottle will stand up well with many other blended whiskies. But it just ain't that big peaty moment. And the reason's simple. The premium for peated whiskies is being targeted by marketing consultants. The price of peated whiskey, I reckon, is going to go up because the majority is produced exclusively on Islay. And due to vested interests, we will see more distilleries on Islay, but what we will not see is a great increase in the capacity of Islay distilleries. And that is an opinion. That's me gazing into my crystal ball and just about to say, do you know what I've noticed in the crystal ball? This vlog, this whisky review's about to finish now. All done and dusted. One more smell, one more taste before I go. If you buy a bottle, don't initially be disappointed. Stay with it. Like many whiskies, persevere. Leave it a few days, leave it a few weeks, come back to it. Let it breathe, let it open up and settle down. We should always come to a glass of fresh poured whisky without prejudice. In good company, it's a great leveller. Thanks for watching. Pop back soon for Whisky Review 451. Because this was Whisky Review 450. And oh, what fun we have.